Amen. This morning, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, verses 28. Verses 28 to 41, we're going to look at 35 to 39 as we begin this part of it today. Luke chapter 19, verse 35 to 39, and it reads as follows. And they brought him to Jesus. And they cast their garments upon the coat. And they set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. And when he was come nigh, even now, at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in earth and glory in the highest. Let us pray. Our Father in God, we give you honor and glory this morning. We worship your name. We say hallelujah to you today, dear Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Because the work is finished.
Yes.
Jesus, your son, came to earth. And today we remember his triumphal entry into Jerusalem to complete the work that you have sent him to earth to do, dear Lord. And that is to seek and to save the lost. To give them the message of peace to the world, letting them know that they can be reconciled to a holy and a righteous God. Oh God, we praise your name. We come with a heart of gratitude and a heart of praise today, dear Lord, thanking you for what you have done through Jesus Christ and that you have given us the victory in life because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross so many years ago, dear Lord. Bless this time, dear Lord. Bless our minds, dear Lord. Teach us something new from your word today, dear Lord. Use me as your humble servant, dear Lord, to speak the truth of your word to your people and to myself so that we can grow and live a victorious life because of what Jesus Christ has done, not only for us, but in our hearts.
Yeah.
Oh, God, we praise you. We commit the service once again into your hands. For we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you so much. You may be seated. As a Christian, I believe and I know that you are victorious. We saw you are a victorious person because we are talking about, as a Christian now, we are in Christ. We have been born again. Christ's blood has washed us. We are being redeemed. And the Bible says in Ephesians that we have all the blessings in Jesus Christ in heavenly places. We are victorious. Many times we don't realize it yet. Life seems to be so hard. But we are victorious. We are overcomers. We are people who are being redeemed. We are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. You have all of this in Jesus Christ. Today, you ought to have come this morning with an attitude of gratitude.
Yes.
You ought to have come this morning with a rejoicing in a heart. Somebody is saying it's bubbling. It's a bubbling in my soul. I feel it. I like it. But Jesus has made me whole. See, because when Jesus made you whole, you have the victory.
Yes.
So you got the joy. Somebody said the joy, joy. I don't know where they're coming from. They're coming. Joy, joy, joy. Down deep in my heart,
yes,
says Jesus made me whole.
Yes.
See, you have the victory,
yes,
in Jesus Christ. Do you know that?
Yes.
If you have been born again, if you've been redeemed, if you've been saved, if you are the child of God, you have the victory in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
You are not defeated. You are more, somebody would say, you are more than a conqueror.
Yes.
Say, well, if you are, somebody say amen. Somebody say yes, but why aren't you acting like it?
No.
You are more than a conqueror in Jesus Christ. Why? Because Jesus Christ came,
yes,
to earth. And we can see today through our divine imagination as he made that triumphal entry into Jerusalem so many years ago, my friends. Jesus came to earth so that you and I would have a victorious life. So that you and I, who are dead in our trespasses and our sins, could be made alive and whole again. through his life and through his sacrifice. See, so this morning, we want to take just a few minutes, and we're going to be talking about the triumphal entry of Christ on that blessed first Palm Sunday. We, you know, because we, you know, and when you look at Palm Sunday, you look at it, that I think that was the first ticker tape parade. They had the palm branches and they had all the garments. But you know, you like winners. When somebody win a championship, what do? They have all of these. The town get turned upside down. They have a big parade. The Bible scholars indicate that during this time of Passover, there was about 3 million people in Jerusalem when Jesus came on that first Palm Sunday, and there was a big commotion in the city. And so we're going to talk about it because we believe and we know that if we are born again, we ought to be living a victorious Christian life. Mm-hmm. You should not be living a defeated Christian life. No. Your joy should be bubbling up no matter what circumstance, no matter what situation you're doing or you're in. God should be, your victory should be there.
Yes.
Your heart and your mind should remain focused upon Almighty God.
Yes.
My friends, and so this morning, as we begin today, we're going to understand that as Jesus enters Jerusalem, there are some truths that we can learn about the victorious Christian. And we ought to be evident in our hearts and our lives. Because a lot of times, we don't realize that. And we live so much like we defeated. Like we, you know, like everybody has to run over us. Not understanding that we have the power to move mountains, to part the sea, to turn the world upside down. We got it in Jesus Christ. So the first thing we're going to look at, and it's the first characteristic of a victorious Christian, because the question is, are you living a victorious Christian life? And then so the first characteristic we want to know, that a victorious Christian is focused on the Lord's purpose or will for their life. A victorious Christian is focused upon the Lord's purpose or will for their life. The Bible tells us in verse 28 of Luke chapter 19, it says this, 28 to 35, it says this, and when he had thus spoken, he went before ascending up to Jerusalem, and it came to pass when he was come nigh to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. See, the king is about to make his triumphal entry in Jerusalem. The king is about to enter the eastern gate of Jerusalem. See, my friends, after this, after Jesus entered the eastern gate, after this was over, the eastern gate was shut. The eastern gate, if you go to Jerusalem today, the eastern gate remains shut. Because the eastern gate will not be open again until Jesus made the second entry, the second return. See, and look here, the Muslims, what they do? They try, they understand, they read the scripture. They understand that when the Messiah returns, he's supposed to come to the eastern gate. And what the Muslims do? The Muslim, they got the rock of the mound there, and in between the rock of the mound and the eastern gate right there. And what they did, they put a graveyard right in between there so they can't open the eastern gate. They think that, see, no graveyard would prevent, because they said they want to prevent Jesus Christ from coming back a second time. You go today, you go to Jerusalem, and you go to the eastern gate, and you see it sealed up. Because God said in the scriptures that the eastern gate is supposed to be sealed up. But when Jesus returns, it will be wide open.
Hallelujah.
See, my friend, this is the first time that the Messiah is presenting himself as the Messiah, and he's coming now through the eastern gate. And so things got to be right in order. So Jesus was going down, and he stopped. He stopped right there at Bethpage. Then he gives some instructions. See, when people give instructions, when you give instructions to somebody, you expect them to do what? To follow the instructions that you gave them, right? Right? And he gives detail. Now, Jesus didn't say in the scripture, go and get a donkey. Let's read what he said. In verse 30, he says this, Go, he said to them, go ye into the village over against you. In which, as you are your entering, ye shall find a colt. Now, at your entering, say, if I go in the village, and those days, I gotta find many colts there. I don't see donkey on the left, donkey on the right, colts there, goes there. But you gotta listen to what he say. Whereon yet never mind sight. Say, Lord, how in the world we can know if he in the butt, if somebody saw on the donkey? This is the first time he even see it. The first time. But Jesus said this, loose him and bring him hither. Now that's easy to do. I'll go down there, loose one and bring it back, right? But listen, and if any man, see, and Jesus covered everything, and if any man asks you, why do you loose him? Thus shall he say unto him, because the Lord had need of him. And they that were sent went their way and found even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosing the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, why loose ye the colt? And they said, the Lord had need of him. And they brought him to Jesus. Now, if we look at that, we can know some things, see? Because if you are a victorious Christian, you know, you ought to be focused on God's will, my friends. And as we look at that, Jesus gave clear instruction. Because it was the will of God that Jesus should go to Jerusalem to be crucified. And in order for that to happen, these disciples now had to go and get that colt, the right one, the one that was appointed for this day, and bring it back to Jesus. Now, look at this. When Jesus gives us a word, it is clear. There ain't no in between. Jesus gave clear instructions to his disciples. See, my friends, a lot of us today are called children of God. God has given us clear instructions in his word. But we don't read God's word. We don't study God's word. We don't spend time in God's word. And so we don't know when the tests come. When life challenges come. We don't have no word in our soul to hold on to. Jesus gave them. He said, come. When Jesus calls you, he calls you and then he sends you to do a work. Jesus' instructions were clear. Jesus' instructions covered the unexpected. Unexpected. As these two men went, they say, all right, that's fine. I can go and loose the colt. But then what Jesus said, look here, and if anyone, unexpected, if anyone asks you, why are you losing a colt? Well, you know, so, see, Jesus expected a challenge. See, in life, as you follow God's word, as you follow his instructions, some challenges are going to come your way. Don't think you're going to, because why? The enemy, a lot of times, don't want you to accomplish what God wants or calls you to do. And so some challenges is going to come. So when the challenges come, what you going to say? What you going to do? See, I can say, man, look here, why are you bothering us? Be doing this. Don't ask me no question. I can say, man, look here, I can't, just don't worry about that. See, and think about it, God sent two disciples. And if you know the scripture, it says the owners, I mean more than one, and then there's a colt. This is valuable. A colt that no one else has ever rode on. That means it's even way more. And you just comment. See, and the Bible shows us this, that Jesus covers this unexpected. Why? Not only does he cover it because he knew somebody was going to come, but he also prepared them. Because, as we look at this, we know that those men better respond because Jesus gave you the word to say. Now, if Jesus gave you a word to say, why are you preaching or are you teaching something else? Jesus gave you a word. Jesus said, if anybody asks you, don't get no argument. Just tell them this. The Lord had need of it. The Lord had need of it. It's plain and simple. That's all. The Lord had need of it. And so all the man said was this. The Lord of it. See, when God calls us and he sends us, he says, study, know my word, teach my word, preach my word, share my word. He said, the Lord had need of it. And there was no argument. Why? Because God has people in places that you don't even know. God has people that he's working with in office buildings that you have to go in. and bites that you need to go in, and countries that you need to go in that you don't know. He said, all you gotta do is follow my word. Go to this place, this code. Don't go to this one over here. See, because if you go to this one over here, you got some fellas who can deal with you rough. They can rough you up. But go to this code, but it's tied up and loose this one. See, when you, see, it's simple, but it's important that you understand, if you don't follow the word of God, you can end up in a whole bunch of trouble. You can end up in a whole bunch of situations, right? Because, and so the only thing they said was the Lord had need of it. And once they repeated the words of Jesus Christ to the man who came to them, then that was it. The next thing is, they didn't, no argument, no debate, no price, no nothing. The next line was, and they brought him to Jesus. Just like that. No problem. Why? Because they follow the word of God. They accomplished the task. God sent them to do a task, and they fulfill it. Jesus sent them, and they fulfill it. See, that's what victory is. Victory is fulfilling the task to which you were sent. Victory is accomplishing the task to which God has called you to do. This life that we live, this victorious Christian life, God has called us out of darkness in this marvelous life for a reason, for a purpose. Are you fulfilling? Are you accomplishing what God has called you to do? Or are you busy doing other things? God said, follow my will. And the Bible said, they brought him to Jesus. One day you and I will stand before Jesus. One day you and I will stand before him. And our life will be laid out bare before Almighty God. What will he see? Will he say, well done, thou good and faithful servant? One day, we're going to come and return to him. We're going to stand before him. Will he say, blessed, enter the reward of your Lord? Jesus sends us to do a task. And he wants us to accomplish the task to which he has sent us to do. And then the second thing we know, a victorious Christian has a deep worship life. A victorious Christian has a deep worship life. Now, the Bible tells us, in verse 37 to 40, that they had a prayer service going on. They had a worship. They had a procession going on. And we want to read that, and then we're going to break this down a little bit for you. It says this, and when he came nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in earth and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. They had a worship time. They were rejoicing. They were joyfully praising God. And loud voices are saying, Hosanna. Hosanna, which means save us, Lord. Save us now. They were rejoicing. A great expression of praise. And Hosanna is a great expression of petition. Because it says, save us, Lord. And then they're going to say, save us now. And that's all they were saying, save us, Lord. Because they said, Jesus is the King. The King has arrived. He's going to run the Romans out. He's going to break everything down. And he's going to take over. The Messiah has come. Very loud crowd stirred. They shouted praise. They were jubilant. The people were excited. But why? The whole city was moved. They were really in a worship. Or were they? They were really in a worship. Or were they really in a worship? Many thought Jesus was coming to put down the ruthless rule of the Roman Empire. They thought Jesus was going to be their new earthly king and not their spiritual king. A few short days later, a crowd was crying out with a loud voice, "Crucify him!" The same crowd was saying, "Hosanna!" was now crying out and saying, "Crucify him!" What a did they have a deep down worship life? Were they really connected to God? Was it genuine? Were they grounded and rooted in God? Or was it just an outward show of expression? Jesus said, if people won't praise him, the stones will. The heavens and the stars declare his glory. Where's my focus of attention? How's my worship? Is it just a shallow water worship? Everything is fine as long as we're in the shallow. You ever had the people on the beach? When they go on the beach, everything fine as long as they stay in the shallow. Right? But when you cast them out in the deep, it's another story. God is looking for deep water Christians. But, you know, when God tells Peter, cast out in the deep. I want you to be a surface level believer. God said to Peter, cast out in the deep, deep water. Because then your faith is exercised. Yeah. It's manifested and things start to happen. And then Peter cast out in the deep. Many things happen until Peter ends up on prostrate in front of Jesus. Depart from me, for I am a sinful man. Lord, leave me. Deep water Christian. God don't want shallow water. I'm Christian. Are you a shallow water Christian? Let me see your hands. A victorious Christian life you're talking about. A deep, serious examination. How much can I love the Lord? A commitment. How much am I committed to God? Are we stirring in our spirit to worship the one true God? What's the depth of our love for God? Is it just on Sunday morning? Is it just to show up and mark the ticket? Is that Crescent? But this is a real, genuine. Jesus came to earth on that first Palm Sunday day. And the people were rejoicing and praising. But it was a shallow water praise. It wasn't genuine. Because many are still looking for the Messiah. They able to believe he came the first time. It's over 2,000 years later. The crowds that day had many reasons for their jubilation. Some correct and some incorrect. But see, my friends, God is saying to you and I, he wants deep water Christians, victorious Christians. Are you going to be victorious today? Are you going to be victorious today? God wants you to be a deep water Christian, a victorious Christian, a Christian who is able to do great and mighty things. See, and that's why God said daily, you ought to be examining your heart. You ought to be examining your heart. Daily, you ought to be looking within you. Allow God to say, search me, O God, and know my heart today, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and cleanse me and make you. Daily, you ought to examine. Who am I? Am I following God? Am I doing what God has called me to do? Or am I just a shallow water Christian, just coasting along? I want all the meat. I want all the benefits. I want all the substance, but I don't want to commit myself to serving God and doing what God has called me to do. See, my friends, the victorious Christian is a Christian who is a deep water Christian. And then a victorious Christian, don't bring no tears, or bring no tears to the eyes of Jesus. The victorious Christian bring no tears to the eyes of Jesus. You ever made anybody cry? You ever made anybody every time they see you, they cry? Huh? I mean, you show up and they start to cry. They start to cry. What happened to you? But the victorious Christian bring no tears to the eyes of Jesus. But the sad thing about it is that so many Christians bring tears to the eyes of Jesus. The Bible says in verse 41, And when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it. Only a couple of times in the Bible, Jesus wept. He wept in Lazarus' tomb. And this is another time he wept. The Bible says he wept. Man, look over the city. He wept. In the midst of the jubilation and the joy, in the midst of the hosanna and palms, in the midst of the cloak and the garments and all of the stuff, the Bible said Jesus wept. He wept. He wept. And I said, what in the world? In the middle of all of this, Jesus cried. He wept. You bring tears. Oh, my goodness. Jesus cried. All the pitting I see on when Jesus, or they assume the images of Jesus that they paint and whatnot, they don't show the tears. They just show, you know, Jesus on the horse or the donkey, but they don't show no tears. But the Bible says he wept. Why the tears? Why the sadness in Jesus' eyes? First, there was because of the superficial belief. Many were shallow followers of Jesus. Shallow, they just going along with the crowd. People just followed the crowd. I believe a lot of the people who marched yesterday and the other day, they just was following along with the crowd. Many of us get like that. We get sweep up in the crowd. There were many of us shallow followers of Jesus, motivated for the things Jesus could do. He could provide such as food, healing, health, and power. But spiritually, even nothing was there. They were following Jesus for the wrong reason. They were looking for the earthly bread. And Jesus wanted them to follow the bread of life. See, that's going to be mixed up. Because it's more than the earthly bread. That's why Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds. See, God is life. His word is life.
Yeah.
But they were following Jesus for food, for healing, for health, for power, for popularity. And many today are still following Jesus just for those things.
Yes, my Lord.
And well, Jesus is looking for a relationship. They're looking for someone who just will give them a handout. And it's more than that. The tears came to Jesus' eyes when he looked over. While man looked at the ultimate parent, Jesus was looking at the heart. And he started to cry because the heart wasn't right. The heart wasn't in tune to the will of God, because if they had known who was on the donkey, if they had known who was there in their presence, they would worship him in spirit and in truth. Jesus cried because of the spiritual blindness that he saw in the crowd around them. They were blind. He knew what was in their hearts. He saw the city. They were blinded. There are many things that blind us today. The world, the flesh, the devil, were the root cause of our blindness and sin. They had sin in their heart. They held on to sin. You don't want to let it go. Someone somewhere said, let go and let God have his way. No, we say no to God. I don't want to let go. I just want to have that superficial worship and not a true and a genuine reflection of you. Jesus cried when he saw that in the people. The blindness was so great. Over 3 million people was in Jerusalem that day. Could you imagine the blindness? The rulers and everybody else said, tell your disciples, shut up. And Jesus said, if my disciples would be silent, the rocks and the stones would cry out. The victorious Christian, my friends, life is so pleasing and comes to God as a sweet aroma. The Lord is rejoicing, heaven is rejoicing by the victorious Christian's life. When God looks at the victorious heart, he rejoices, he smiles, he don't cry. When God looks at your life, is he crying or is he smiling? Is there tears in his eyes or is there a smile on his face? God is watching. He's looking at our life, at our heart each and every day. He knows where we are. He said, come home. Let me bless you. Let me touch you. Let me see. That's why Jesus came, because he came to transform our life into an abundant life. But as long as we hold on to the darkness, to the blindness of this world, the trivial things of this world, we'll never be all that God would have for us to be. It ain't worth it. Jesus cried because of the rejection and lost opportunity. Jesus knew in the midst of the celebration, he would be rejected in just a matter of days. Can you imagine that? People celebrating today, worshiping today, and then next, crucify him, get rid of him. And we say, oh, Pastor John, they did that. I don't do that. And Jesus shows up. I'm meeting time every week, and we just, oh, that was great. And then we go and we forget about him. You reject him on Monday. You reject him on Tuesday. You reject him on Wednesday. You reject him on Thursday. That's why a lot of times it's so difficult to get people out of church, because their number one focus is not Jesus Christ. It's just their personal gain. And I hope you realize that the most important thing in your life is Jesus Christ before it's a day too late. Because only Jesus Christ can help you in this life and in the life to come. Stop rejecting him. Allow him to have his way in your heart. Allow his power, his might, his grace, his mercy, his peace, his love, his understanding to move deeply within you. Don't let just have a surface love. You gotta have a love that is deep down in your heart for Almighty God. Your life, your priorities should be governed by your relationship with God. When the Lord, my friends, look on your heart, will tears well up in his eyes? That's the question you can ask and answer to yourself. Recognize the time when God comes to you. Do I know God is speaking to you, my friends, today? And he's saying to you, he's saying to me, I'm here. I'm here. Don't reject me. Open your eyes and see. I want you not to have a shallow spirituality, a shallow relationship. I want you to live a victorious, powerful, mighty Christian life. Now. I want you to go from height to height in my spirit. I want you to do mighty things in your life for the glory of heaven. I want you to say, when even the demons will know who you are. They say, Paul I know, Jesus I know, and you got to be powerful and mighty in the things of the Lord. God want to use you wherever you are today. What are you holding on to? And then the last one we want to note this morning is this. The victorious Christian has peace with God. See, a lot of us are in war. We are in war and war with God. I don't know why we're fighting God. Why are you fighting God? Because that's a losing battle. Why are you fighting God? Why don't you like to win? Why don't you like to be blessed? Why don't you like to be rejoicing all the time? Don't fight God. I mean, if you're fighting God, you're fighting the wrong one. I mean, because who hands up, who's stronger than God here? Someone, songwriter said, my God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. See, my friends, we got to understand, you got to stop fighting God. You got to have God. Jesus came to earth. As he rode it, he came to bring peace. When the angels announced him, they would say, he is a prince of peace. His message was a message of peace. Why? Because you and I were at war with God. Because we were outside of God's family. We were alienated. We were sinners. And sinners get out of our fellowship with God. And so Jesus came to bring that message of reconciliation, to bring you and God together. And so he came with a message of peace. Jesus came as a peacemaker. So See, because God is all right by himself, but he wants you to get fixed. He wants you to get mended. He wants you to get restored. And Jesus came with a message of peace. The Bible says this. Verse 42 says this. Saying, if thou, Jesus is saying this, if thou hast known, even thou, at least in this day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. What a powerful verse. It's like a double emphasis up front. It said, say, if thou hast known. And he'll say, what? It just said, if thou hast known. See, you got so much in Jesus Christ, but you don't know because you're blinded. Some people say, if I was right there that Sunday morning when Jesus came, I would have been. No, you would have been just like that. Blind. Swear away. He said, if thou hast known, even thou. See, there's a double emphasis. See, you got to know, and you got to know. It's deep. He said, if thou hast known, life was filled with choices, my friends. The choice of salvation is eternal and is critical. See, and it's so important, you know, that you know. He said, Jesus said, if thou hast known. See, it's important that we know Jesus Christ. Know Jesus Christ. Say, no Jesus, no peace. No Jesus, no peace. Yeah? See, either you know Jesus and you will have peace. If you don't know Jesus, you will have no peace whatsoever. No matter what. Say, Brother John, I live a good life. I don't get in trouble. I don't steal. I do my job. I provide for my family. I don't get, you know, I'm a mortal citizen. My friends, you still ain't got no peace. Because the Bible says you are born in sin and shaped in iniquity, my friend, and you need the salvation that only God can give. There's no peace in your heart, no peace in your life. The troubles that you have, you don't need to have no trouble. You need to know Jesus is. Know Jesus. The only way you're going to have peace is when you know Jesus. But if you don't know, if you don't have no Jesus, then you have no peace. Psalms 29:11 says, the Lord blesses his people with peace. Mark 11:9-10, those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. They were looking for peace. Hosanna, save us now. Admit your sins. Allow Jesus Christ to grant you and give you the peace that he came to give. Believe in Jesus. Believe Jesus took your place on the cross. Confess him as your personal Savior. And watch God do a great work in your heart and in your life. God is able to do it. He is able to do it for you. Because he wants you to live a victorious Christian life. He wants you to live a life that is full of joy. He wants you to be an overcomer. Jesus made a triumphal entry into Jerusalem over 2,000 years ago. But nobody recognized who he was. They didn't recognize him. My friends, Jesus is coming a second time. And he will make another entry. He will not come as the humble Messiah that time. He will come as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And he will come to the eastern gate. And he will receive his people. Are you going to be ready if you're alive that day? If Jesus will come today, will you be ready to see him? Will you be ready to go with him? Will you be ready? If you want to die today, will you close your eyes on this side and open up your eyes in heaven? Huh? That is the question Jesus came to give us the answer to. Because he said, absent from his body is present from the Lord. He said, today, you will be with me in paradise. My friends, we ought to be living a victorious life because we ought to have that joy down in our eyes. Because we don't have nothing to worry about. Paul is saying this, to live is Christ. To die is gain. Then why? Because to live, I live a Christian life on earth. I fulfill the call of God on my life on earth. But when I die, I have a glorified body. I have glorified. No more pain. No more suffering. No more stress. No more headache. Why? Because with Christ, I am a glorified being. But while I am living on earth, I live for Christ. And as you live for Christ, don't live as a selfish Christian. Live as a Christian who loves people, who care about people, who reach out to people, who share the good news with people. You got the good news. You got the word that Jesus said. If anybody asks you, why are you living like this? Why you do this? Why you pray like you pray? Tell them, Jesus' word says this. If anybody asks you, what's different about you? I don't understand you. See, you got to tell them, let me tell you something. I got a Savior who is Jesus Christ the Lord. I used to be doing this, and I used to be doing this, but when I met him, he transformed me. And now I am on the way. I said, I am no longer my own. I have been bought by a I am saved and I'm heading to heaven. My friend, let me tell you. I have the joy in my heart. Why? Because I know that I absent from this body, I am present with my Lord. My friend, I have the hope of Jesus within me. You gotta start. You gotta know what God's word says, and you gotta share it. Don't be quiet. Talk to people about Jesus. While you have a chance, because someone's gonna ask you anytime. God sent you to do something, somebody's gonna ask you, what you doing? Why are you doing it? And you gotta be able to say something. Give them your own humble testimony about your relationship with God. Because when we get to heaven and we start to look over all that God has put in our path, the opportunities, the people, to share, to invite, to touch, to pray with, all the things, all these people. The question is gonna say, what? I don't want people to say, be shocked. Say, oh, I didn't say nothing then. I know the Holy Spirit is prompting me, I didn't say nothing. Oh my, I know I should have said something. No! Say something. Invite them, talk to them. Tell them about Jesus. Pray with them. Because, my friends, I guarantee you, people are going through some things that they need prayers for. People are going through some stress that they need prayer. They are living defeated lives. And you got the victory. You got the joy of the Lord. You are being redeemed. You are God's child. You have the good news. And people are suffering, looking for this good news. And you got it, and you're sitting right next to them. And God is saying to you and I, open your mouth. Share, love people. That's the problem. We don't love people enough. We don't care about people. Jesus cared about us so much that he rode on the donkey knowing where that would end. Knowing that he would end in the tomb not so many days later. Why? Because he loved you and me. What love we have. We have the love of God. And you ought to praise God each and every day because of his goodness and because of his love. I want you to live a victorious Christian life. Follow God's word. Evaluate your worship each and every day. Evaluate how deep your worship is with God each and every day. Allow God to have his way in your heart each and every day. Allow God to lead you and guide you each and every day. And watch him bless you. Watch him watch over you. And watch him take you places you never expected. I'm working for my eternal reward. I want you to work for your eternal reward. I want all of you to receive everything that God has for you. I want to bless you here. I want to bless you in heaven. But you got to follow his will. Follow his command. Follow his word, and only when you understand and know, you gotta read it, you study it. On Wednesday nights, we have a wonderful time in Bible study and sharing and praying. Come out, be a part of it. Because all of us can help each other grow and mature in the things of the Lord. Because we got a work to do. There's some people in your workplace that you've been praying for and you need to see Jesus. Come, let's pray for them. My friends, watch God do a work, because I want God to save. Some people are going to die that you know this year. Stop being quiet. And share the good news of Jesus Christ to them, because they need to hear it before it's a day too late. The victorious Christian life. God wants you to live victoriously today. Let's bow. As we bow this morning, and as you think about your life and where you are today, are you living victoriously? Have you trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Where are you today? If Jesus Christ would have come this morning, if he would have returned, would you be ready? Would you be ready to go with him? If you're not ready today, now is an opportunity for you to trust in him as your Lord and as your Savior. And I pray this morning, and as you bow, that you would say this prayer with me. If you are sinning, you want to come to Jesus this morning. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I come humbly to you today, asking for your forgiveness of my sins. I repent of my sins. I confess my sins. I ask for your forgiveness. And I receive Jesus Christ, your Son, into my heart today. I pray today, if you pray that prayer, that you would come and seek me or the sister pastor out today and let us know that we can counsel you well. Pray with you. And then you can be also a part of the baptism of class that is going to happen in just a few weeks. And maybe you're here today and you're a Christian, but you know, you haven't been as committed as you would like to be to the things of the Lord. You say, Pastor, I want to become more committed. I want my life to be more committed to the Lord. Just raise your hand and I will note that this morning. Yes, I see hand. Anyone else? Yes, I see hand. Anyone else? Yes, okay. Anyone else? Say, Pastor, I want to rededicate my life to the Lord today. I want God to do a great work in my heart and my life. Is there anyone? Yes, raise your hand, I'll see that. Yes. And then today, maybe there is someone that you've been praying for, that they would give their heart to the Lord. But you haven't spoken to them. You haven't shared Jesus with them. You want them to change, but you haven't reached out to them in the way that God has been encouraging you to do. And you want us to pray with you that God will give you the strength, the guidance and the direction and the wisdom in dealing with them. Just raise your hand if you'll see that. Yes, I see hand. Anyone else? Yes. Anyone else? Yes. Saints are raising their hands all over the auditorium today. Because we know, all of us know, that there are people that God has bringing to our lives for us to be a witness to. That is your mission field. That is the one that Jesus Christ sent you to. pray for you this morning that God would use you in a way, in a mighty way, to be a testimony to them so that they would come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Oh God, this morning, we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh God, your spirit is moving. Oh God, your word has been spoken. Oh God, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your love. We thank you, oh God, for your faithfulness and for all you continue to do each and every day in our hearts and in our lives. Oh God, as we look, and as we, oh God, look at the hands that were raised, dear Lord. Oh God, there's many souls that yet need to be saved. And oh God, I pray in Jesus Christ's name that you would work, oh God, and each person that raised their hand, indicating that there's someone or persons that they would like to reach for the kingdom of God, dear Lord. I pray that you would use them in a mighty way to speak your word to them. To model the life of salvation and a Christian life before them, the Lord. To give them the power in their prayer. Pray with them, the Lord. Oh God, I pray this morning that they would reach out to them and bring them into the family of God through the power of your spirit, the Lord. Work even now, the Lord. Touch their tongue. Cause them to speak the truth of your word to them, the Lord. Convict the hearts. Give everyone that they're going to reach out to receptive hearts. Receptive to the word of God. Open to receive the truth that you use your children to speak to them, the Lord. And bring them in, the Lord. So that they, oh God, will come to know Jesus as their Savior, as their Lord, as their personal Savior before it's a day too late. Oh God, we pray in Jesus' name that you will strengthen each and every one of us, that we will live holy and godly lives. Help us today, dear Lord, that we will not have a shallow water Christianity. Oh God, help us that we will walk and we live in the deep water, dear Lord. Covered in your blood, walking in holiness. May your spirit, may your anointing rest high heavenly on your people today, dear Lord. Oh God, I pray in Jesus' name that you would touch us down deep in our souls, that our spirit will be revived within our beings today, dear Lord. That we will remember that we serve a risen Savior and that we ought to rejoice in him today, dear Lord. Oh God, I pray for your people today. We thank you, oh God, for Kevin, who came out today, dear Lord, in spite of his illness, in spite of his difficulties, dear Lord. We thank you that he had a heart to be with the people of God on this blessed Sunday morning. We thank you for the miracles that you're doing in his heart and in his life, dear Lord. May your anointing be upon him, dear Lord. May your blessings continually be with him, dear Lord. And may, oh God, you can continue to restore and heal his body in Jesus' name. Oh God, we thank you for all who's out this morning, dear Lord. We pray your blessings upon all of us. And we pray, oh God, that those who need a healing from you, dear Lord. Oh God, I believe that you are God who heals. I believe, oh God, that you are God who is able to do great and mighty things. I believe, oh God, that you are God who cares and understands. Oh God, I appeal to you in Jesus' name, asking that you would touch those today that need a special healing from you today, dear Lord. Touch their bodies, dear Lord. Revive them today. May your anointing be upon them, dear Lord. Oh God, I pray in Jesus' name, because your word says to God, ask. Jesus, your son says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's what you do. Oh God, I ask not in my name, but in the name of Jesus Christ, your son, the most holy one, the Lamb of God, I ask in his name that you would touch those this morning that need to be healed, and that you would bring healing to their bodies, revive in their spirit, strengthen them within them, the Lord. Oh God, and oh God, allow them to see the hand of God in their lives. Let them be a testimony of the goodness of Almighty God. Oh God, I praise your name today. I just rejoice in you. I thank you, oh God, that Jesus, the faithful one, came on that blessed day and entered Jerusalem through the eastern gate because he loved me. Because you love me. Because, oh God, you didn't want us to perish, but that you want all to come to know you and come to be your children once again. Oh God, we pray that the good news we have as your children, the salvation, the message of reconciliation that we have, will not just be kept to ourselves, but help us that we would share that good news with persons and people that we come into contact with, and that they will come to know you as Lord and Savior. Oh God, help use us in a powerful way, that your kingdom will be expanded to the faithfulness of your people. We praise your name, and we rejoice in you, and we say, Hosanna in the highest. Hallelujah to God, our King.
Raise your voice and say,
Hallelujah.
Sing.
Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty
reigns.